Mande Atomics, bienvenidos a un Atomic Show VIP bastante especial porque nos acompaña ni más ni menos que uno de los guionistas del estudio Monolith, Andy Salisbury, para hablarnos sobre el juego de Shadow War. Yo soy David Berrones, me acompaña
Rodolfo Vikingo
el amor. Welcome to Mexico, Andy. We're so glad to have you here.
Thank you so much. Thank you guys for having us. This is great.
Yeah, we're big fans of not only the games from your studio, but also from everything Tolkien, Lord of the Rings. We even look like a couple of orcs.
Yeah, we are orcs.
You are orcs, yeah. Is orc your spirit animal?
Or dwarves, you know, because the orcs and the dwarves are the best.
Oh, yeah, they look more like a dwarf, I think.
Yeah. I think my spirit animal is just a hobbit. I just want second and third and fourth breakfasts
with
all day.
With all the
fruits. Yeah, exactly. We don't. The camera stays strictly, yeah. Okay.
But it has a, you know, like...
Come on, man, I told you that in confidence. Jeez, that's...
Yeah, thanks for being with us. We're really excited. The game came out this week. And we've been playing it for a couple of days now. It's a great. We're fans of the first game. So, but first of all, I wanted to ask you, you know, if someone who hasn't played the first game, do you think it will have a problem entering this game?
You know, not at all, actually. That was from the very beginning of making either Shadow of Mordor or Shadow of War. That was a huge consideration. You know, we knew that there was going to be a lot of people with Shadow of War that hadn't played Shadow of Mordor. So in the very beginning hours of the game, I think we do a really good job of catching the player up from a story standpoint, but also too, you know, as you kind of work your way through all the new mechanics, there's a lot of great design in there to make sure that they're kind of given the right skills in the right order and everything, or, you know, that you get skill points in the right order to unlock the really great abilities that play most to your strengths. So, you know, from the very beginning, we knew that there was going to be people that hadn't played Shadow of Mordor, but also, too, you know, we really took it upon ourselves to write a story that is as epic as we could make it, one that really pays off the promise of a story told to you in Tolkien's universe, but also one for players that, you know, hadn't even touched The Lord of the Rings or even watched the Peter Jackson films.
Just a quick reminder, where in the timeline is Shadow of War set?
Yep, so it takes place in between the events of The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, and so it picks up the story right after Shadow of Mordor.
But before the events of the Fellowship of the Ring, I mean, how much time would you say?
You know, it's
that a spoiler?
It's tough because we're kind of like, we're really just placing it in that time period. There's about a 60 or 70 year gap, I believe. I think it's probably closer to 60, if I remember correctly. In between the events of those two books. And so it was great because there was so much known about the events before and after, but we had this really rich playground of a lot of interesting moments where, you know, Mordor is the place where the biggest military campaigns in Middle-earth history is taking place. So we also had a lot of rich history to pull from as well. But that kind of takes place in that 60 year period.
And which was the main challenge of writing this story? Because, you know, it's The Lord of the Rings, and it's Tolkien, and it's so huge in the world, and for all the fans, you know?
Yeah.
Which one was the main challenge of writing this story?
You know, it was interesting because I think in a lot of ways we sort of challenged ourselves, which I know sounds kind of silly, but a lot of our research was not only reading the professor's books, but also his letters to the editor, and to find opportunities where we could actually kind of learn more about his motivations and the themes that he thought were most important in the Lord of the Rings universe and in all of Middle-earth. And so as we kind of walked into this process, it was a lot of self-vetting. You know, like Michael DePlatter, the guy who basically is the head developer for Shadow of, basically the guy behind everything Shadow of, you know, he's like this incredible mind that learns through osmosis almost, and so he's become this incredible check and balance with all the overall themes of the world. And then we also have a Tolkien scholar on staff who checks every single thing we do to make sure that we're staying true to the lore and true to the themes that are present in the world. So it was a lot of looking at what was most important, I think, to the stories told in Middle-earth, but also too, for us, it was, I don't know, it was an important opportunity, I think, to make sure that, you know, when we were digging into his letters, there was one passage in particular where he said, you know, I wrote many passages in this world in great detail, but I left other areas for other creators to come and pick up. And so I think, as such diehard Tolkien enthusiasts, it was it was an opportunity, but a responsibility as well.
Yeah, that's just, you know, very clever. From Professor Tolkien, because he was a great, he has a great mind, and he wrote all universe, a lot, and also, as you say, he took a napkin and, you know, write something and lived, you know, for years. And right. He was like a crazy guy.
Yeah,
you know?
It was incredible, the stuff that came out of his mind.
And,
my goodness.
And you have to get close with the one Lord of the Rings specialist or something like that, you say?
Yeah. We have a Tolkien scholar on staff. Her name is Janet Croft. And every line of dialogue, every story beat, every single collectible that has text or anything applied to it, she's there to make sure that she's working alongside us. To you know, just to ensure that we make the best possible game in Middle Earth.
Yeah, and not only on the English spoken dialogues, because the local team were telling us that for the localization in Spanish, they had a specialist from pronunciation.
Yeah.
So the voice actors here in Latin America could be truthful for all the Lord of the Rings lore.
Yeah.
And just as a little parenthesis, we have great talent in the local voice acting. People like René García, Carlos Segundo. And in English too. I mean, we have Troy Baker coming back, and who else is on the cast?
So we still have Alistair Duncan as Celebrimbor. We still have Liam O'Brien, who is Gollum in so many pure ways.
He was great in the first.
Yeah, and then we've also we've actually expanded. I'm having trouble remembering all the different names of the actors we have, but it's been cool. I think especially to watch Troy come back because he was so connected to the creative of the first game. You know, like he really helped us. I think in a lot of ways. Realized who Talion was over the course of development, and so he's got this incredible mind, and he really put himself to task this time being our performance capture director. So every single scene you play, every single scene you see play out in the cinematics, he was down there on the soundstage in LA with those guys going through every single scene as someone who was so closely connected to the first game, who understood the format really well, you know, having acted in that setting so many times, it was something that he was so familiar with, and it really shows. Like, it was such a fun opportunity to sort of have our story sort of dialed up to the next level.
It's great that someone who's really passionate about the project, it's part also on the voice acting and directing, as Troy. You know, we loved the first game. It was critical acclaimed and loved by Lord of the Rings fans. But sometimes we think that it was a little bit overlooked by a lot of people.
Sure.
Do you guys had always planned to expand this universe or... why do you decide to make a sequel?
You know, I think from the very beginning when we were developing Shadow of Mordor, it was a learning process in a lot of ways. You know, it was the first time our studio at Monolith, we'd ever made a third-person action game or an adventure game or anything. And so, obviously, starting from that format, there was a lot of opportunities to learn and kind of build upon what we all thought was best. But also, too, with the Nemesis system, you know, there was a lot of stuff where just... you know, for one reason or another in the first game, we just didn't have, you know, the tech or whatever it was to pull off all of our craziest ideas. And so I think when we were looking at what was going to come after Shadow of Mordor, this team was still just so fired up and still just so full of inspiration. And so a lot of what you see in Shadow of War are our craziest, best, most exciting ideas. And so I think it was really important as we kind of took the next steps forward into Shadow of War that we really aligned ourselves to make sure that, you know, we knew that we could get the most out of what we built previously, just because we had had such a great time making Shadow of Mordor, but also too to kind of align it with, you know, what our fans and community were saying, because there was obviously a lot of moments and a lot of mechanics present in Shadow of Mordor that were so important and so galvanizing. So it was, I think, this really great collaborative process of looking at what we felt was most important from our standpoint with our own plans, but also to kind of aligning that, you know, with our Reddit community and people that are posting comments on news articles and people that come out to us on our Facebook and Twitter account. So it was a really great process, I think, of just sort of taking all the best ideas we could and just going for it, just dialing it up to 11.
One of the best parts of this game and Shadow of Mordor is the Nemesis system. It's awesome.
Thank you.
And but in terms of narrative, you know, mm-hmm. of the story,
sure.
What are the changes that we can expect as players, you know, and what's the challenge of building this awesome system with the decisions of the players and all this, that stuff.
Yeah, you know, it was actually cool because when we looked at the Nemesis system, one of the most interesting things to me as the community manager was, you know, we write these stories that we're really proud of and we're excited for players to dig into and kind of find these cool, interesting stories within Middle-earth, whether it's hanging out with Hirgon or Lady Marwyn. And then as we moved into Shadow of War, you know, this time around, I think starting with that point and making sure that we have this great backdrop for the entire world, you know, we have this incredible in-house writing team led by a guy named Tony Elias, who is just outstanding. Like, the world he's been able to put together has been really integral to basically stitching together this great new story that really pays off the promise of a tale told in the Tolkien universe, but then also, too, having them so connected to the Nemesis system. And from the very beginning, you know, we have a lot of these cross-discipline meetings at Monolith where every single discipline, whether it's an animator, a writer, a producer, a designer, everyone comes into the same room to make sure they can really kind of look at what's best about every single opportunity that the Nemesis system presents. So, you know, the first time in Shadow of Mordor, it was all about these one-on-one rivalries. You know, you'd have all this bloodshed and revenge, and this guy who chases you down across regions, and you throw him into a fire, and he comes back with a big, huge fire scar down his face. Yep. And so we took that and dialed it up as much as we could. So we have now these great new tribes, which can dictate the personalities, which can dictate the combat styles and the advanced classes and everything. So that was a really great way to, I think, expand a lot of player story opportunities. But two, then one step further, was we then basically improved the follower system tremendously. So it's not just taking one of your guys and sending him on a mission and hoping, you know, you can go help him out, or maybe he'll win or lose, but he'll actually remember the interactions he's had with you. You know, if you send him on a mission that's a total death wish, he manages to survive, he might come back and be really upset about that. Or if you're on a fortress assault with him, going out there fighting side by side, tooth and nail, you know, these are guys that you've been on missions with. If one of those guys across the entire fortress is bleeding out, but you've been working with him side by side, you've been going out on duels with him to make sure he survives, to go on beast hunts with him because he's getting put up against a Grog, you know, to really make sure you actually help these guys grow, is such an important part of building your own story as well. And that obviously culminates in the big fortress assaults, which are these, you know, huge, like, there's one fortress ruling every single region. They're these huge Helm's Deep scale battles that we put together that has been so much
fun. Excited,
yeah, it's like, it has been so much fun just to get to work on it, to see it come together from day one, you know. And then those two have these huge impacts on the whole region. So if you're able to conquer it, depending on what overlord you put in, his tribe is going to dictate so much about the world. You know, if he's a member of the machine tribe, he's going to go ahead and actually they're going to have different outposts with smokestacks popping up across the region as they start really firing the furnaces of war and building their army up and everything. Or if it's a member of the mystic tribe, they're going to be dabbling in the dark arts a little bit more, and there's going to be a much eerie feeling set to the entire zone. So, and the missions are going to change, the ambient life. It's really been this huge process of making sure that you as a player get an experience all your own, you know. And to finish the story I briefly started earlier, where, you know, with Shadow of Mordor, it was so cool to us that every single time people came out to us, they would tell us about their nemesis. You know, it was these 3 to 4 paragraph epic stories that they put together where, you know, the story that we wrote in the backdrop was there, but they were just so focused on really building their own story and having a playthrough all their own. And so that was such a core component for us, is making sure that, you know, it was such an inspired storytelling device in a lot of ways.
I'm getting really, really excited.
Do you have a favorite orc in this sequel?
Actually, it's interesting because I think he's going to be one of the guys I bring over from Shadow of Mordor.
Oh, cool.
So one of the cool things actually that we did was we released a free update for Shadow of Mordor called the Nemesis Forge, and that allows you to take your top nemesis and top follower from Shadow of Mordor and bring them with you into Shadow of War. So Ogbur the Dreamer is the one. He's the one I'm going to hunt down mercilessly from the very beginning, because he gave me a real rough time in Shadow of Mordor.
I think one of the topics of our community, and personally one of mine, is the new Ring of Power.
Sure.
You know, that when I see it for the first time, I thought something like, what?
Right.
But
yeah, how's that possible?
Can you explain us something of the new Ring of Power? What?
Yeah, the implications.
The implication of having a new one, because you know the one ring.
Right.
And there's two rings.
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, but it's awesome. You know, it's not bad.
Yeah.
It's an awesome thing, but. Can you explain us?
Absolutely. Yeah, you know, so the thing is, with the new Ring of Power from the very beginning, you know, actually to rewind just to a quick step, at the very end of Shadow of Mordor, Talion, you know, stares the camera in the eyes and basically says, the time has come for a new ring. As we move forward into Shadow of War, we learn that in a lot of ways, Talion and Celebrimbor now having been bound together for so long, and Celebrimbor having been the greatest smith of the Second Age of all of Middle-earth, is this being, you know, he gave the One Ring its subtlety, he put the inscription on it and everything. And so, as we walked forward into Shadow of War and kind of started developing that story, you know, it was clear that these characters were so motivated with their one singular enemy in Sauron. And so, forging a new Ring of Power that's free of Sauron's taint and everything, and and is this new pure power that they can use, that's the one tool they see as a thing that can actually go and actually, you know, take a fight directly to Sauron, because it has the power to dominate and it has the power to bend wills and everything. So it's been really interesting to kind of watch as you have this character like Celebrimbor literally pour all of his power into forging this new ring, and it kind of creates a lot of new story opportunities where, you know, Talion and Celebrimbor now have a much more, you know, I think it's interesting because they kind of come to their own. They have a very different relationship this time,
yeah.
But they still have that one singular enemy. So as they were walking forward into forging the new Ring of Power, they knew that that was their opportunity to forge an army all their own behind enemy lines.
Can we say that Talion and Celebrimbor are like friends, but not friends, like an enemy, like a lover?
Maybe a little bit, yeah. Certainly,
because everything.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it's interesting because they've been working together now for so long.
Celebrimbor is like using Talion in a certain way.
You're picking up on some of the themes of it. Yeah, absolutely. You know, like he sees Sauron as this enemy that absolutely must be stopped. But obviously, in the way getting there, I think he uncovers a little bit about himself that might suggest that, you know, he's got, I don't know, he and Talion are very different people. I don't want to spoil anything.
How much of the influence of the Peter Jackson movies you consider you guys have?
I mean, they were huge inspirations for us. You know, obviously, even as we were walking into creating the Fortress Assaults, you know, Helm's Deep was such a key inspiration for us. As you kind of look at this big, huge, epic battle and what it really means to have armies marching against each other on Middle-earth, and what it is to, especially with all the races and all the different, you know, combat styles they have, what it means for all those guys to really just go ahead and conquer and take over a fortress, or, you know, whatever that might mean. And so I think as we dug deep into the Peter Jackson films as a point of inspiration, whether it's visually or from a storytelling standpoint, you know, there was a lot of key components from there that we learned a lot from.
Of the three, which one's your favorite film? I mean, maybe of the six.
my favorite, I will say my favorite's The Two Towers.
Oh, yeah.
For sure. It's one of those ones that I think, you know, in The Fellowship of the Ring, they do such a brilliant job of setting up a lot of the characters and getting you this close to a payoff.
Yeah.
And then in the second film, it's just like all out war and just like the drums pounding and the fires burning and like getting introduced to all these brand new characters and races that are so important. So, I don't know, to me, The Two Towers, especially the extended edition, it's a very close place to my heart.
Yeah, mine too.
I think the three of us
we're the three Two Towers.
Yeah, yeah. And in Helm of War, you can now customize your Talon that you're equipped.
Yeah.
And we can expect some reference to the movies or other events that are happening in the Middle-earth?
Yeah, actually, it's interesting because as we started making all the armor sets and expanding the loot and RPG systems, it was really interesting to, I think, look at the core inspirations of, you know, who forges what armor and where these places come from, and, you know, like having a full Gondorian set of armor. And, you know, I think it was really fun to, I think, watch our artists dig in deep with all the inspirations behind all those different races in Middle-earth and make sure that you're actually, you know, when you're equipping armor and gear, that when you go after the Feral Tribe and you get the legendary Feral Tribe set, that it really feels like something that an Uruk tribe or an Olog tribe could make, you know, on their own, or had references to the world, you know, as the larger state of the world and everything. But also, too, we make sure that you hold on to the core items that you had in Shadow of Mordor, because those have narrative value as well. So while you can pick up a lot of gear as you go along and kind of, you know, crush it for Mirian, I guess, to help build siege assaults, you're still going to make sure you have Urfile and a car and everything. So yeah, there's a lot of core narrative actually in the loot and RPG systems as well.
Oh, I'm getting so excited, man.
Well, I think that'll be all.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thanks, Sandy, again for being here with us in Atomics VIP. We're really excited for the game as fans, and we have a lot of audience that are also big fans.
That's awesome. Thank you guys so much for having me. This has been great.
Thank you, man. You are an awesome guy, and you do an awesome game, so thank you very much.
Of course. Thank you guys for having us. This means a lot.
That means a lot for us, too, man. Pues bueno,
muchas gracias. Este Atomics VIP, no se pierdan Shadow of War, que está buenísimo. Ahí increíble. El buen Defa hizo la reseña.
Así es.
Y pues seguimos con más aquí. Nos vemos la próxima. Yo soy David Berrones.
Yo soy Rodel Vikingo del Amor.
Y nos vemos la próxima.